Once again, the Honorable Chief Justice of the Republic of South Africa, fellow judges, guests of the judiciary, ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm happy to see all of you here this morning. The annual colloquia, which has become an important annual event for the judiciary, is a great occasion in many ways. As judges, we get the opportunity to be away from our courtrooms and our chambers to review the many activities for the past year and the plan for the year ahead. Indeed, the colloquium enables us to reflect, review, and refocus our individual and collective goals for the year ahead. As an institution, it enables us to keep tabs with the general direction and the pace in the pursuit of our common objectives. Fellow judges, one of the cardinal principles in our Constitution is expeditious delivery of justice, in effect codifying the 17th century maxim, justice delayed is justice denied. In simple terms, this legal maxim means that if justice is not provided in a timely manner, the sufferer loses, it loses importance and violates his or her human rights. That's precisely why rights to speedy trial are incorporated in law worldwide. For example, countries such as India and the United States have made justice and timeliness of delivery of justice a key component of their constitutions. The U.S. names speedy trial as one of the constitutionally assured rights. It is the same in Europe, where we have, for example, the European Convention on Human Rights, which makes specific references to timely delivery of justice. And of course, our Constitution, more specifically Article 159, provides for delivery of justice without delay, without undue regard to technicalities, and to all irrespective of their status. Speedy trials are an integral part of the fundamental rights of life and liberty in our Constitution, as also enshrined in Article 26, and of course in the entire Chapter 4, which is the Bill of Rights. Indeed, as the renowned Malaysian constitutional lawyer Cyrus Das said, and I quote, "Justice is a consumer product and must therefore meet the test of confidence, reliability, and dependability like any other product if it is to survive market scrutiny. Credibility of the judiciary is at stake now, and due to delays in disposal of cases, the denial of justice through delay is the biggest mockery of law. It does not amount to mere mockery. The delay, in fact, kills the entire fabric of justice delivery system in any country." End of quote. This year, ladies and gentlemen, we have deliberately picked the theme of our colloquium increasing speed and the quality of justice, a judiciary service delivery agenda. To give us an opportunity to seriously introspect our past performance, to allow us reflect on the core objective of the judiciary, namely effective delivery of justice. I wish to take this opportunity to commend the subordinate courts, the High Court and the Court of Appeal, for the timely disposal of the election petitions and appeals. You know how emotive those disputes are, and I'm very happy that the subordinate courts, the High Court and the Court of Appeal have disposed of them within the set timelines. Though there are no statutory timelines for the determination of appeals to the Supreme Court, on its part, the Supreme Court is set to determine those appeals, which have been filed, and some are being filed as I even speak, within a reasonable time. While we have been commended for our sterling performance in the disposal of political disputes, ladies and gentlemen, you must be aware that we have equally been censored in other areas, not necessarily because we were engaged in the disposal of the political disputes. That is all in the media, and we have all read. And in the correspondence that we have received in the judiciary. To reflect on that censor, as you have noted from the program, we have set aside the whole of tomorrow morning to interrogate our performance in a number of areas. A list of those areas will be distributed by the director of the JTI this evening, so that we can all look at that and see what we need to do. As we commence our deliberations, I invite all of us to reflect on those challenges and on a number of issues that are relevant to our core responsibility, that is protecting the sovereign authority of the people of Kenya. We should candidly ask ourselves, how have we as judges contributed to the enhancement of access to justice over the past year? Have we observed the ethos of integrity and the ethics? Have we made our courts places of efficiency in the delivery of justice to our people? One of the issues we will discuss is the case of park, the case of is the issue of park laws. There is no doubt that the perennial problem of case park law is a manifestation of a denial of justice to victims. Some of the injustices are clear. We have cases where an accused person sometimes remains in remand in the trial process for longer than the sentence or periods of imprisonment that is likely to receive in the event of a conviction. It is for this reason that we put together measures as part of the judiciary transformation to address the challenges of case park law. And I'm glad that we have made significant progress in this area. Just a little over 110,000 cases, in fact, to be precise, 111,973 are the cases pending as of 30th of June this year, are the cases which are more than 5 years old pending in our courts. We have put together plans and made arrangements to have service weeks in various stations, and I'm assured that we are able to clear this backlog by the end of this year. I want once again to call upon all of us to rededicate ourselves and make sure that we clear these cases by the end of the year. Besides these station-based initiatives, there are many judiciary-wide initiatives that hold great potential for enhanced efficiency. We recognize, for example, that technology can play a key role in bringing justice, in bridging the justice gap. That's why I put the Judiciary Transformation Framework and Sustaining Judiciary Transformation so strongly emphasizes the use of ICT, having recognized its potential in enhancing access to justice. We have, for example, put in place an ICT policy and drawn an ICT master plan. This makes it clear what everyone's obligations are and the procedures to be followed to ensure safe, effective, and the use of ICT. Fellow judges, as you know, the Constitution also provides for alternative forms of dispute resolution, including reconciliation, mediation, arbitration, and traditional dispute mechanisms that should be promoted. Indeed, not many of us know that many of the disputes that our people experience are resolved without coming to court. Research has shown that there are other avenues outside the courts that Kenyans use to address their conflicts. The Constitution is alive to this reality and has called upon the judiciary to facilitate access to these alternative forms of justice delivery. I therefore urge all of us to encourage the parties to employ these alternative methods of conflict resolution, not only because they are a constitutional imperative, but also due to their potential to enhance effectiveness and the delivery of justice in our country. Indeed, I'm happy to report that a lot of work has been done towards enhancing access to justice, ranging from improvements and expansion of our court infrastructure to enhanced individual accountability. We now have a robust accountability scorecard for each court station, as well as performance evaluation for individual officers. A reward system for well-performing courts and the judicial officers have been developed, and in my administrative decisions, as the head of the judiciary, I have already conferred recognition and rewards to some of the stations and judges and magistrates who performed well in the last performance management and measurement reports. This policy will continue. We are committed to pushing this agenda relentlessly despite the emerging challenges. Key among them a commercial break. Hold it for a while, we would definitely need it. We are committed to pushing this agenda relentlessly despite the emerging challenges, key among them being the severe budget cuts in the current financial year. Ladies and gentlemen, we have made a statement on this. I don't want to belabor the point. You saw it in the media, and we have quite a few challenges that we are going to meet. It is shocking, it was shocking to the Judicial Service Commission and to me in particular, that we could be given 50 million shillings for development. That includes repair charges and other things. I have received complaints from quite a number of you for having not even provided them with cars since their appointment. Some of you are very old cars which are breaking down all the time. We have those complaints. And we have raised that. When we were doing the budget, we came up with a budget of about 31 billion shillings. But you have seen from the media what we were allocated at the end of the day. For apart from recurrent expenditure, and of course paying our salaries, we are left with very little to use in our operations. Sometimes we ask ourselves quite a number of questions, and wonder whether some people in this country realize the importance of the judiciary. I say that because the judiciary in any country, in any democracy, plays a key role in the security and economic prosperity of the nation. We are not asking for a budget equal, for example, to the Ministry of Education. We are not asking for a budget, for example, equal to the Minister of Health, that of the Minister of Health. We are not naive to do that. We know that the country requires a lot of resources in those ministries and others. But surely, the country should realize, should know the importance of the judiciary and allocate us the resources we require. We are taking up the matter, and I believe that we are going to resolve the issue. And I want you to bear with us. I want you to bear with us in the difficult times we are operating in, as we try to resolve this issue. I'm convinced that the authorities concerned will see the importance of funding us so that we are able to move on. Let me leave it at that. Let me leave that issue at that. We are engaged with the other agencies, and I believe that the issue will be resolved. So, ladies and gentlemen, please bear with us in the difficult circumstances we find ourselves. This colloquium comes at a time when the principles of independence of the judiciary and the relationship between the three arms of government have also been brought to the national focus. We are meeting at a time when the fight against corruption has gathered momentum and the judiciary is constantly being challenged to rise to the occasion. Under the occasion, we shall rise in a manner that is both consistent with the Constitution and also advances the public interest. We shall be professional, and we urge the other actors in the justice chain to be equally diligent and professional in their work. In this regard, please allow me to repeat for the umpteenth time two things. One, that the judiciary is committed to ensuring that all the anti-corruption and economic crimes cases brought before our courts are dealt with impartially, expeditiously, and in accordance with the law and the evidence presented before us. This is the only way we can maintain the confidence of the people we serve. This is why, in the first place, we established the Anti-Corruption and Economic Crimes Division of the High Court at Nairobi. We have subsequently established two other sub-registries of the same court at Mombasa and Kisumu. Secondly, even as we address the external cases of corruption, we must look inwards and see if there are logs in our eyes that we should address also. We therefore continue to deal firmly with the incidences of corruption and lack of integrity within the judiciary. As a result, we have the following milestones which we have achieved. More than 90% of the courts have established automated revenue collection systems. This morning, and I'm sure some of you also must have seen that, there is a tweet going around about some officers in our courts. Instead of using the M-Pesa to collect revenue, they are refusing to do that. And they are asking the convicts to pay cash. The DCJ has called for a report on that. And we are going to deal with that family. Where we have established automated revenue collection in the stations, we cannot hear of any judicial officer attempting to collect cash, which we are moving away from. The judiciary fund regulations have been gazetted and are pending before Parliament for approval. One of the issues we are pursuing relentlessly is the establishment or the operationalization of the judiciary fund. That's the only way we can be able to have the budget allocated to the judiciary deposited in that fund so that we are not at the mercy of the treasury all the time. Once the funds are deposited in that account, we will of course use them as required in the government regulations, and we will be accountable to the Auditor General. The issue of the judiciary having to all the time experience challenges here and there, when Odunga or any other judge issues an order against the parliamentarians, they cut our budget. We cannot continue operating like that. We cannot continue operating like that. And we have made it very, very clear. I have made it very, very clear that the judiciary has to be funded if it is to perform its core functions. And the funding we are requesting is that we should be given a percentage of the national budget. The recommended percentage is 2.5%. Let them start even with 1.5% and give us that. That's all we are asking for. If you take, for example, the issue of the development fund, we have been getting 2.5 billion shillings for development. Instead of increasing it, it is coming down, and it comes to 50 million shillings. Somebody somewhere is not serious about what we are doing. It is, however, the duty of each one of us to defend the institutional independence of the judiciary, and part of that institutional independence is financial autonomy. Ladies and gentlemen, this year we, as I said, we are privileged to have the Honorable Chief Justice of South Africa grace this occasion and deliver a keynote address. The Chief Justice is an accomplished jurist. He's a man of humble origins, but of great accomplishments. Chief Justice Mweng, the fourth Chief Justice of the Republic of South Africa since the dawn of democracy in that country. Justice Mweng holds the B. Juris and the Bachelor of Laws from the universities of Zululand and Natal, respectively. He also holds a master's degree in law, LLM, from the University of South Africa. In October 2013, the University of Northwest awarded him a honorary doctorate degree, LLD. Justice Mweng started his professional career as a temporary interpreter and was later appointed as High Court prosecutor from 1986 to February 1990. He did pupillage at the Johannesburg Bar and practiced as an advocate from June 1990 until his appointment in 1997 as a judge of the Northwest High Court. In April 2000, he was appointed a judge of the Labour Appeal Court. In 2002, he was then elevated to the position of the judge president of the Northwest High Court. Justice Mweng was appointed to the Constitutional Court of South Africa, the Apex Court, in 2009, and then subsequently he was appointed the Chief Justice of the Republic of South Africa on 8th September 2011, after a very, very competitive process. In that capacity, he leads the Constitutional Court, as well as the South African judiciary. He's also the chair of the Judicial Service Commission of South Africa, the South African Judicial Education Institute, and the National Efficiency Enhancement Committee. In April 2017, Justice Mweng was elected as the president of the Conference of Constitutional Jurisdictions of Africa for a period of 2 years. In August 2017, the Chief Justice was appointed the Chancellor of Natal University. Justice Mweng is a family man. is married to one wife, and they have three lovely children.